So this video is on essay 620, using the work of an auditor's expert is the name of this essay. We have covered another auditor and internal auditor in the previous videos on, under essay 600 and 610. So now we are on to essay 620. Now the first thing which we have in this essay is auditor's expert. First of all, we need to know who an auditor's expert is. The basic thing is that auditor himself is an expert. That's why he's auditing the accounts. But he's an expert in the field of accounting and in the field of auditing. So one thing is for sure, auditor's expert is not going to be an expert in accounting or auditing. Moreover, if he is an expert in accounting or auditing, this would come under non-applicability of this essay. So this essay won't be covering an expert who is an expert in or who is having an expertise in the field of accounting or auditing. So he must be having expertise in some other matter. Maybe architecture could be one, like if there's a building under construction, you need to value the cost of the building. Sometimes the auditor may hire an expert, like an architect who can know what percentage of the building has been completed, etc. Or if he's working in a very complex environment, like in a very new organization or something, like on a new field in which the auditor do not have an expertise, and to understand that complex environment, he may hire an auditor's expert. The third thing with an auditor's expert is that he could be an internal expert or an external expert. Internal expert is one who is a part of the auditor's engagement team, while an external expert is one who is not a part of the auditor's engagement team. And moreover, the auditor do not even have a control over the rules and regulations of the external expert, or what kinds of policies he have, etc. And he has more control on the internal expert. So this is a basic introduction about what auditor's expert is. So writing down the definition of the auditor's expert, he may be an individual, or he may be an organization. Right. Just to give you an example of an organization, there was a recent example of Whirlpool of India Limited. You must have heard about this. I mean, it deals in your air conditioners, refrigerators, and all. Whirlpool is taking the services of the auditor is Bartley Boy, although now it is a part of Ernst & Young, which is a big four. Now, what Bartley Boy did was to understand the environment and to bring out some changes. I do not know exactly what happened, but the service which it took for this as an expert was of a Boston consultancy group. You must have heard about this in your IPCC ITSM paper, which had a BCG matrix that provided some expert guidance to Bartley Boy. So that was just an example of organization. BCG deals in such kind of things. So an auditor's expert can be an individual, or it can be an organization as well. Then it should be possessing expertise. Obviously, then he can. It is then only when we can call him an expert. It should be possessing expertise in the field of, in the field, not of, but other than your auditing account and accounting, right? So possessing expertise in the field other than, in a field other than accounting and auditing, whose work is used by auditor in obtaining audit evidences. He uses the work of the expert to obtain audit evidences. Then I told you that he may be an internal expert or an external expert. And so he or it, he for an individual, or it could be a she or herself, and the organization is being used as it. He or it may be an internal expert or external expert, right? So this is a basic viewpoint or definition of auditor's expert. Now the other one is the management's expert. This too will come under non-applicability, that this essay do not deal with a management expert. But straight away saying that essay do not deal with a management expert won't solve the problem, but because we need to know who the management expert is, only then we can know that whether the essay is applicable or not. So he's the one who is used by the entity. Management is the entities. Management entities are client, right? So the management expert, he is the one whose work, he's the one whose work is used by entity in preparing financial statements. This is the management expert. Right, now coming to the non-applicability, I've already told you to whom this essay is not going to be applied to. The first, as I told you, was that he's an expert, he's having an expertise in the field of accounting or auditing, right? So it's not expert, applicable to expert. When you can frame up the sentence, I'm just writing down the non-applicability point. Expertise in specialized area of accounting and auditing. A simple reason why auditing. You're saying in a field other than accounting or auditing, over here non-applicability means in accounting or auditing, right? And then the other one is that when the auditor is using, auditor's use of, when the auditor is using the work of management expert. Right? So this is, in these two cases, this particular essay 620 is not going to be applied. Now moving on to the auditor's responsibility, in the bracket I've written regarding opinion. This thing says that the auditor, this essay says that the auditor's responsibility regarding his opinion is not going to be reduced. For example, in the audit report, this is AR means audit report. In the audit report, as the auditor, that is we as an auditor, are writing down some points what we have observed. And at the end of the audit report or in the middle of the audit report, we give an opinion. Now, this opinion is maybe affected by the work of auditor's expert. So now we have given an opinion. Why? Because auditor's expert said something to me. I am the auditor. He said something to me and my opinion changed. So I gave, for example, a modified opinion. When I found that what the expert told me was not right, instead it should have been an unmodified opinion, or it should have been an adverse opinion and I have given a qualified opinion, etc., etc. So my opinion is not right. So I cannot hold that expert responsible. I cannot say that I gave such an opinion. Why? Because that expert told me this, or that expert brought these facts to me, etc., etc. I am the one, that is the auditor, is the one who is going to be solely, that is individually, no one else is going to be responsible for this opinion. Only auditor is going to be responsible for this particular opinion. Auditor's responsibility regarding the opinion will not even be reduced when he's using the work of his expert. So the auditor has sole responsibility of his opinion, that is audit opinion. His responsibility is not going to be reduced. By the use of auditors expert, when he's using the work of auditor's expert, is not responsibility is not going to be reduced. But at the same time, he may use the work of auditor's expert as an evidence. This is for sure. I mean, that's an automatic or an instinctive thing that you may use the work of an auditor's expert as an evidence. That is the only purpose you are using the auditor's expert. He provides you the evidence, so he may. However, he may accept the work of auditor's expert as an evidence. So these are the responsibility of the auditor. He may use the work as an evidence. Now we are coming on to the objective of auditor's expert. Sorry, the objective of the auditor. Now he has to determine two things. I've made a frame of this. The first thing that he has to determine is that whether he should use the work of auditor's expert. So determine whether to use, this is a single sentence, the objective of auditor is to determine whether to use work of auditor's expert. This is the first question he has to answer. If the answer is yes, that he should use the work of auditor's expert, then he'll come on to the adequacy, as we did in essay 610 as well, whether the work is adequate for his purpose or not. So whether we have, this is a single sentence, objective of the auditor to determine whether the work is adequate for his purpose. His means the auditor, the principal auditor, the auditor of the client. He's not the expert, right? So the objective is to do these two things. So the first thing is that whether to use the work of auditor's expert or not. The same can be, we can write as why do we need the auditor's expert. So first of all, the auditor has to consider whether it is necessary to use the work of auditor's expert or not. He has to decide this, that whether it is necessary, do he really need the work of auditor's expert, whether it is necessary to use the work of auditor's expert. Now In the beginning of this video, I gave you an example that of the auditor's expert that he that maybe the client the auditor is working in a very complex environment and he needs to understand the complex environment, so he may hire an auditor's expert. So this could be a reason why we need an auditor's expert. So in the second one, we can write an example that the auditor's expert. This is an example which was given in the a book issued by the Institute of Chartered Accountants of India. Auditor's expert may be required to understand the entity operating in a complex environment. Right? To understand the entity operating in a complex environment, basically we are understanding the environment only, we may require the use of an auditor's expert. Now, the second objective was whether the work is adequate for his purpose or not, determining basically the adequacy of the work. So we have some procedures, auditor's procedures. This is auditor's procedures with respect to determining adequacy of work of auditor's expert, how we are going to determine whether the work is adequate or not. So in this, I've made a diagram of four points regarding what the auditor shall consider in order to determine the adequacy. The first point, second point, and I'm continuing the diagram on the third this page. So if you have space, you can make the diagram on the single page. This would be the third point and this the fourth point. So in a continuous sense. So the first thing, what the auditor has to do. First of all, the auditor shall consider competence, capability and objectivity of the auditor's expert. Whether he is I do not think that it needs any kind of explanation. Whether he is competent enough, whether he is having a technical knowledge or not, whether he is capable to be and to provide the information that we require, whether he is objective. Objective means it is not influenced by wishes of others, or it is not influenced by any other external factors which may reduce the credibility of the work of auditor's expert. So he is not biased, etc. This thing we'll examine basically the auditor's expert's nature of the auditor's expert as a person or as an organization, what it is up to. So first thing, we shall consider this if he is competent, if it is he is capable, if it is or he is an objective person, then we'll say that the work is adequate. So data adequacy test, we can say adequacy test will clear. You will clear this particular thing. Now the second point. Understanding the field of expertise of auditor's expert, and we are understanding the field of expertise. As I gave you an example of the architecture, he is from the field of architect. So first of all, we need to understand the field of the auditor's expert. Now, how can we understand the field? By through discussion with him, by discussing. So through discussion with him, we'll discuss with him and opinion understanding of this. What is the use? It will enable the auditor to do what? In evaluating, it will help the auditor in evaluating the adequacy of the work, right? For the basic purpose of this is that we need to determine whether the work is adequate or not. So by understanding the field, the use will definitely be that it will enable us, or it will help us to determine whether the work is adequate or not. So it helps the auditor in evaluating the adequacy of work of auditor's expert. Right, so this is the use of understanding the field of expertise of the auditor. Now we are on to the third point. So as I told you, this is in continuous. This was the first this was the first point, then we had a second point, now we are on to the third point, right? And then the fourth would be the last point as far as this diagram is concerned. Now, agreement with the auditor's expert. There should be an agreement with the auditor's expert. So between whom? The auditor's expert and the auditor, there would be an agreement. So the auditor shall agree with the auditor in writing. The agreement is going to be in writing on the following matters. There would be some matters on which they need to agree in writing. The first thing is the nature, scope and objective of whom? Of that expert. What he is going to do, what he is expected to do, what is the scope of work he can perform, how many maybe what kind of transactions he can audit, and there would be a limitation on the scope because he is working under the auditor, so he definitely do not have the right to each and every document. So whatever the scope is, what the nature is, what is the objective which the auditor is sorting of by giving some work to the auditor's expert, etc. This has to be in writing. The second thing is that the role and responsibilities of the auditor and expert should be in writing of both. So, okay, so the role and responsibility of whom? Of the auditor and the expert. Right. And then we have the timing of communication. Again, between the auditor and expert. This is the second diagram. This line is for the second diagram. I hope you can differentiate. So the timing of communication between auditor and expert when they will be communicating, this too should be in writing. The fourth and the last point, which has to be written down, is the need to observe confidentiality. Need for the auditor's expert to observe confidentiality. Confidentiality means I mean, not disclosing the important documents to any third party. He should be confidential that he do not disclose any information to the third party without having an approval from the auditor for whom he's working. So the need for the expert to observe confidentiality is also going to be written down in the agreement between the auditor's expert, right? So this was the third point. Now moving on to the fourth and the last point of this diagram. Evaluating adequacy of the auditor's work. This is what we have to do. We have to evaluate the adequacy of the auditor's expert. Now, what do we have? This is a straight line going down. I mean, this. So we're just taking a look in these two points. Okay. So evaluating adequacy of auditor's expert's work. How can we evaluate? By considering these four things. The three things are regarding reasonableness. Other is to ensure consistency. So how can we ensure? How can we evaluate adequacy of the auditor's expert? We can evaluate it by considering reasonableness of expert's finding, whatever he has found out. Expert's finding. We consider whether they are reasonable or not. Then reasonableness of assumptions used by the expert. He would definitely be using some assumptions, and they need to be reasonable. The auditors need to consider whether they are reasonable or not. Then the reasonableness of source data used by expert. He should this person, I mean the expert is going to be using some data. They should be the data being used should be reasonable. Then the fourth point which the auditor needs to consider is that there should be consistency between what the findings of the expert, whatever he has found out, the expert would definitely the expert has been hired to find out something. Whatever he has found out should be consistent with other audit evidences. So the auditor shall consistent shall consider the consistency between the findings of that expert, whatever he has found out, and other evidences. Right, there should be consistency between these. Now, the second part of this point is that first of all, we learned about how we are going to evaluate the adequacy. Now, if we evaluated the adequacy and found out that it is not adequate, then what the auditor has to do? There's one option left for the auditor, and that's in that is perform additional, or we can say further. And even further would be a better word. We always use further audit procedures. Further procedures. If you find out that the adequacy of data experts' work is not adequate, but then you need to yourself perform further procedures. So this was regarding auditors' procedures with respect to determining the adequacy of the work of audit procedures, the auditors' expert work of auditors' experts. So we have covered this thing. Now there's a small topic of this essay which is left, and that's a very easy and a logical one. Now the point is reference to auditor's expert in auditor's report. When the auditor will be framing an opinion in this audit report, he may give a reference that he has used the work of auditor's expert. And the basic thing is that for the time being, ignoring exceptions, we are ignoring exceptions for the time being. The basic thing, as far as audit report is concerned, is that if you're giving an unmodified opinion, there is no use. I mean, if unmodified opinion, first of all, you need to watch my videos on SA 705 and 700 to know what unmodified opinion and modified opinion is. But for the timing, if you are with this video only, unmodified opinion is something that your the auditor has audited your financial statement and they are true and fair. A modified opinion is that the reports are not true and fair. So if the auditor concludes that the reports are unmod giving is gives an unmodified opinion, there's no use or there's no need of including the auditor's expert's reference. There's no use of referring the auditor's expert in our audit report. But if in case it is a modified opinion, then in that case we need to give a reference to the auditor's expert. Again, I'm saying there would be exceptions and one exceptions each. So the first thing we are the first case is we are giving an unmodified opinion. Now, in unmodified opinion, unless and until it is required by law, there's no use. That is, if the reference is required by law or regulation, then you need to give reference to. So the auditor shall refer to auditor's expert in his audit report. And while when he's referring the auditor's expert in his audit report, he need to indicate in his audit report that his responsibility as far as his opinion is concerned is not going to be reduced. See, I've written down this idea as well. Auditor has sole responsibility of his opinion. In the responsibility, we can cover this. His responsibility is not reduced by auditor use of auditor's expert. If you have given an unmodified opinion and you are giving a reference to the auditor's expert, you need to include this these sentence, you can say, as it is in your audit report. So shall refer to the auditor's expert and indicate in his AR means audit report, indicate in his audit report that auditor's responsibility is not reduced for the work by using the work of auditor's expert. Right, so he shall refer to the auditor's expert and indicate in his audit report that auditor's responsibility is not reduced only when the reference is required by the law or regulations. If it is not required by law, he shall not refer to the work of auditor's expert. Refer to work of auditor's expert would be a better line, I would say. Shall refer to the work of auditors expert if it is required by law, otherwise not. Now we're coming on to the modified opinion. Now in this case, see, the reference is necessary for if this is the case one, all right. So if the reference is necessary for understanding the nature of modification, you have given a modification and it is necessary that you provide a reference to the work of auditor's expert. Why? For having a good understanding of the nature of modification. Why you have given a modification? If it is necessary to understand the nature of modification that you include the reference to auditor's expert, then you should refer to the auditor's work or expert's work. Okay, so if reference is necessary for understanding the nature of modification, he shall refer and indicate the same thing again. This thing will again come. So in a way, we can conclude that whenever you are referring to the work of auditor's expert, you should also indicate in your audit report that your responsibility as an auditor regarding the audit opinion is not reduced. Otherwise, shall not refer. That is, if it is not necessary for understanding the nature of modification, he shall not refer to the work. Right. So this was SS 620. So by this, I also complete the series of SS 600. Thank you for watching this video. You may subscribe my channel and like my video. Thank you so much.